Good morning to all of you. I once again thank Prof. Venkatesh for this opportunity of communicating with you on this occasion. So, I have chosen a somewhat general and simpler theme, and I do hope we will benefit from whatever I have to say on a few things. So, the title, is Geometry and Diophantine Approximation. Now, of course, all of you would be familiar with Cartesian geometry, introduced by Descartes. Now, one of the crucial things that happened at that level, at that point of time in mathematics, is that a certain unification of geometry and numbers. So the world of geometry and the world of numbers, which sort of existed independently over the almost 1,000 years, more than that, from since the time of the Greeks and so on, came together, and we saw how geometry is actually related to algebra, and an equation it typically represents a certain figure which has its own geometry, and each figure typically can be represented by either an equation or by some formula, and so on. The next step in this sense, so when you want to talk of when you think of relation between geometry and numbers, the next thing one sort of came to the fore is, let's say you have a subset of the Euclidean space, the space of numbers, the plane or the three-dimensional Euclidean space, or in general the n-dimensional Euclidean space. You have a certain subset given which comes from some procedure, something in the and in some way we are going to be given the subset, and then one would like to know whether it contains an integer point. Among the numbers, of course, you know that integer points have a special role. So in many practical contexts, an irrational number would not make much sense. You cannot have the number of goats has to be an integer. Many practical things have to be integers, or sometimes you can make them into fractions, but not necessarily, not in general, not the irrational numbers. On the one hand, the irrational numbers make the world of numbers very rich, and it plays an important role, but we need to be anchored to the idea of integer numbers. So, like the one question that arises is whether, given certain subsets, you can say that there are integer points in that. And where should I point this out? Point it there. Yeah. One of the crucial theorems in that respect is this theorem of Minkowski. I should actually have introduced the name here. It's the theorem of Hermann Minkowski. Take a convex and symmetric a subset of Rn which is convex and symmetric, where convex means inside the subset, whenever you have you draw any line, so a set is said to be convex if something like this, where you can join any two points by straight lines. This is said to be convex. On the other hand, to draw a simple picture, this is not convex, because when I try to join these points here, the line would go outside the set. So this is convex, this is not convex. Similarly, there's the idea of symmetry. So in the Euclidean spaces, you have for each vector, there is a certain negative of that. There is a symmetry about zero that one can talk about, and so if you make the assumptions that your set is symmetric and convex and symmetric, and further assume that its volume is greater than 2 power n. Now you can as far as this theorem is concerned, you can start interpreting this for n equal to 2 and 3, and that already gives you a new idea of what it is about. So now there is a technical point that needs to be clarified here. So every such subset, if you take an arbitrary subset of the plane or the three-dimensional space or n-dimensional space, in general it may not make sense to talk of its volume. Nevertheless, you know that for polyhedra, when you have a polyhedron, you can slice it into smaller shapes whose volume you can completely understand, and therefore you understand how to define, how to talk of the volume of a parallelepiped. Now, we can convince yourself that any convex set of this form is always an increasing. I can express it as I can draw polyhedra in the two-dimensional case. I can draw polygons which you can make bigger and bigger and approach the whole convex set. So this is, for instance, one of the oldest way in which people actually, in the ancient times, people calculated the area of the circle. So area, the area of the circle you simply determine as you take, let's say, to begin with, take a hexagon. Then double this, you take a finer polygon, and so on. And you keep repeating this process, then you get closer to the area, and that's how the area was computed in ancient times, including by Aryabhatta in the 5th century. That is the procedure adopted for computing areas. Okay, so for a two-dimensional subset, a convex subset, area does make sense. You can talk, you require symmetry, and similar things are also ascertained for in all dimensions. So the contention in that case is that when you have a set with these properties, then it necessarily contains a non-zero integer point. So a point with integer coordinates. Let me try to convey what this is telling you. That we have, let's say, this is the coordinate plane. Let's say these are the units in that. So the integer points are consist of all the integers along all these lines. Now if I have let's say if I have a box type set, and my condition in this case is that for n equal to 2, the condition is that the area should be greater than 4. Pardon my not having drawn this symmetrically. So we want symmetry. So to emphasize that, let me make this symmetric at least from this side. So now in this case, it should be obvious to you that this will contain a non-zero integer point, because the area is the product of these two sides. If that is greater than 4, at least one of them is greater than 2. And it's stretching symmetrically in from 0, and so in this case, in this figure, you see that this side is has length greater than 2, and therefore it will contain a non-zero integer point. Similarly, you can also see that it's not difficult to verify the conclusion for other simpler figures like the circle, etc. But the issue comes to of ascertaining similar things. So when You are not looking at a box which is nicely slanted along the coordinate axis, but if you take something which is draw a line with a slope which is not rational, so it is passing through a point whose coordinates, so x, y, the ratio of that is not, let's say, is not rational. So this is a line with an irrational slope, and take a strip around this. Okay. Now it's no longer clear that such a strip is going to contain a point with integer coordinates, no matter how far you go, right? I mean, there is no immediate intuitive or elementary way of ascertaining that this is true. But the theorem tells you that if you have ensured that you have gone far enough to make the area to be greater than 4, then definitely there is some you would find some point in that. So maybe in this figure I have to go far enough here, and then this will contain this point. Or if it is still thinner, if the strip is still thinner, then you may have to go still farther so as to make the area to be greater than 4. But the contention of the theorem is that when you have ensured the area to be large enough to be greater than 4 in this case, then it will necessarily contain an integer point. Okay. I made some additional observations here. If you further assume the set to be closed, then it's actually not necessary to say it's greater than 4, but it's just sufficient to say at least 2 power n. So when n equal to 2, at least 4. Now this result is actually optimal in this. You cannot here, so long as you are talking about an arbitrary convex symmetric set, the condition of the area being at least 2 power n has to be optimal. Let's look at the case of n equal to 2 and look at the square. Let's look at this. So I have these points 1, 1, symmetrically placed, and this is the symmetric square around 0. Now let's say I take the set which is the square with those vertices, but excluding these points. Okay, I exclude all the four. Take the square, but take away the four corner points. Okay, now observe that even after taking away the corner points, the set remains convex. It also remains symmetric, and its area is 4. It's missing the theorem by simply being just 4 and not greater than 4. And with that situation, it actually doesn't contain any point with integer coordinates. These actually have been removed when I constructed that set. So there's a certain situation. There are certain situations for which the result is also actually optimal. You cannot expect anything better. Okay, as I already noted, for slanted sets, irrationals, this is something, or similarly, you could also have slanted elliptical regions. So I could take elliptical region, which however the axes are slanted along a certain line whose slope is not rational. So then again the content becomes non-trivial for this thing. Okay, so one fallout of about this strip that I talked about, I said that so long as the area is big, greater than 4, so long as the area is greater than 4, it's going to contain integer points other than 0. Now in particular, so the interesting thing to note is that if I just take the strip, infinite strip, that definitely contains, the area is infinite, so it's larger than any number you want, therefore that will contain, it will contain non-zero into integer points. Now in terms of your Cartesian geometry, it actually this can be interpreted even in higher dimensions. You look at the set of vectors with coordinates x1, x2, xn, where the absolute value of li x1, x2, xn is less than epsilon, where these are linear functions. So they are of the form a1 x1 plus a2 x2, etc. And so if you take n minus 1 of these, so let's say in the case when n equal to 2, this is, you are taking just one form, and the region will then define the kind of infinite strip that we defined here. On the other hand, when you have more dimensions, then you're chopping off in various directions and then forming a certain set. But the point of fact of having only n minus 1 of them will ensure that the still area is still infinite. It's at least, there is at least some direction along which the, it will contain full lines and it will contain sets of that form, and therefore the set will contain, will have non-zero integer points. So these geometric considerations, now with these geometric considerations, we have now concluded that this set of inequalities, which is a purely number expression in terms of numbers, will have a solution which is which consists of integers, where all these x1, x2, xn are integers. Now instead of n, let's also look n minus 1, let's also look at a full complete set of linear forms which will define a parallelepiped in general in n dimensions, and let's say the width of along each of these is given to be, say, epsilon 1, epsilon 2, up to epsilon n. The lth linear form is chosen so that the width of the, this you will recognize is related to the width of the strip. And so suppose I'm looking at inequalities of this form, so this is a certain parallelepiped in the n dimensional space, and now the theorem will, Minkowski's theorem will tell you, give you a sufficient condition when, in terms of the coefficients of these, of course, the coefficients are going to be important, without they define the, okay, in terms of the coefficients of this, as well, and as far as these widths of these strips are involved, you will only need to know what the product is. The product is what will correspond to the volume. Yeah, so let's say if you have n equal to 2, then you are taking two strips, one let's say in that direction and another in this direction. So there's a parallelepiped defined, and so the calculations about that can be made in terms of the coefficients of these and the widths that you asked for, and with that you can determine whether the there exist integer solutions. Now this is already, it has non-trivial content, but nevertheless it's still something that seems intuitively quite that one can easily appreciate. But when you go from linear expressions to quadratic expressions, so a quadratic form is an expression of this form, of this kind, so q of x1, x2, xn is summation aij sigma aij xi xj, where these are real numbers, and there is no, without loss of generality, I can take them to be symmetric. So I can, if there are two distinct coefficients, I can take the average and put put it at both places. So, and one would be interested about, there's a vast variety of problems where one is interested in values of these kind of expressions, and whether I mean the integer solutions to various kinds of inequalities. Now, already Minkowski's theorem turned out to be crucial in this, in his time, for non-trivial integral solutions of quadratic forms. So these are quadratic forms. Now, let's say look at a simple situation, simple expression of the kind, this kind, say a1 times x1 squared, etc., up to an times xn squared. This you recognize is a quadratic form, and this is positive for application of Minkowski's theorem. You'd need that it is positive, because there's a convexity condition, and that will hold only when these coefficients are positive. And okay, it's symmetric already. The other condition is satisfied, and we are taking AI positive, and for this, these kind of expressions will by the theorem, they will have a non-trivial solution. And you want to solve an inequality of the form q of x1, x2, xn is less than say given alpha. So this is a kind of elliptical region in n dimensions, and the size of the ellipse is determined by the bound that you are putting, and the volume of, so Minkowski's theorem, if you use Minkowski's theorem, what you need to do is to know the volume of this standard ellipse, and knowing the volume of the standard ellipse, you would know the volume of this for every ellipse, and it's in terms of alpha and the volume of this. And whenever it exceeds 2 power n, then you will have a solution, and this turns out to be a quite useful strategy, and that's what I mean. So it was found to be the most effective way of being able to identify how far you have to go to find locating a non-zero integer point. Okay, so that is for the elliptical regions. Yeah, so this I already said. And one point to emphasize, however, is that unlike in the case of parallelepiped, we saw that for parallelepipeds, Minkowski's theorem is optimal. Unless it is satisfied, you don't get you can always construct a counterexample. For in the more general case of elliptical regions, namely the quadratic forms, these results are not quite optimal. There are theory developed further, and there's work of Ziegel which gives you better estimates or better weaker conditions under which you can also conclude. That is simply for some general information. Okay. So now let's look at the conditions involved. We have so far treated the condition that the volume should be greater than 2 power n, and we have seen what happens if it is not followed, etc. But let's look at some of the other conditions. Firstly, the convexity. So convexity condition is in fact needed, because I'll show you with a diagram in what context it fails, and so let's again draw the now let me take two lines with irrational slopes. I'm taking these two lines with slopes irrational, and I draw a hyperbola which is asymptotic to and symmetrically on all sides, and you will recognize that this kind of region is has an expression algebraically in terms of q of xy equal to alpha x minus y and beta x minus y. So if you take the linear forms corresponding to this, the product being less, it will lie inside a region like this. So that a region of this of the kind that is so if I write the expression alpha x minus y times beta x minus y, then the region determined by a condition of this form is hyperbolic region of this kind, and I'll be looking for integer points, points with integer coordinates other than zero within this region. Now it might come as a it should come as a surprise. I first got to know about this, that you can have such regions where inside, though their area is infinite, right? You can easily compute the area, and the area is infinite, but nevertheless it's possible to have the slopes of these lines in such a way that this whole region doesn't contain an integer point other than zero itself. That's that's the content of this slide here, and I'll not go deep more details. There are numbers which are called badly approximable. A number is said to be badly approximable. So there's a theory of approximating irrational numbers through rational numbers, and so here you take that as an irrational number and minus p by q, and there are numbers for which this always exceeds delta by q square for all integers pq in which q is not zero. And this in fact holds for very familiar numbers like square root of 2 and in more generally solutions of all quadratic equations with no rational root. So and there is also a more general criterion in terms of what are called the continued fraction expansions of this, so for identifying badly approximable numbers. So all in all the point that I want to make is that convexity condition is in fact needed to ensure that there is a non-zero integer point. Now I'll digress and mention that the phenomenon that I said of constructing such sets with no non-zero integer points turns out to be something specific to dimension 2. It turns out that for higher dimensions it is known. So this is an aside, it's not an application of Minkowski's theorem. In fact, Minkowski's theorem completely fails to address any such question. So if you take a non-degenerate quadratic form which we exclude positive definite and negative definite forms that were involved in Minkowski's application of Minkowski's theorem, and look at these inequalities, this always has an integral solution. And this is a deep theorem of theorem due to Margulis, and I also had the opportunity to work with him in that connection to take the issue forward. But I'll leave it at that. Not say more about it. There is a theory of Margulis which was aimed at solving this question, and then out of that came a new more further development with the work of Marina Ratner, and it's one of the very significant developments in the last 3-4 decades. Okay, let's move on. And now what happens to sets which are not symmetric? The symmetry was another condition. So let me again go to the board. And so we have noted that if I take a strip about zero, then no matter how thin it is, so long as you are taking the whole stretch of that, there is always a non-zero integer point. But we can let's ask the same question. Suppose I take not about zero, but something which is not symmetrically located, so they so just move the step, move the step in some in a direction, so in a direction which is not along that, so you get a new strip, right? Now the Mikoski's theorem you cannot apply any longer because there is no symmetry in the set. For this problem, it turns out that one can actually conclude that no matter where the strip is, even after translating, it will have some integer points inside the strip. And I'll not go into the proof of that. It's an exercise which you can try to do yourself, because this condition can be reduced to a lower dimension, and one can conclude that the same thing is true. But on the other hand, but this is a rather special case. So as I've said here, in general, if I remove the symmetry condition, then in general it is not possible to get the same conclusion as in Mikoski's theorem. On the so except in I've specifically made us. Made an exception for these, for which it does turn out to be possible with elementary methods. So, the issue on the whole, the issue is rather complicated, and the main new thing that I'm going to say is related to this non-symmetry aspect. Okay. And the point to emphasize is that in general there is no simple criterion like Minkowski's theorem in when the sets are not symmetric. But here is a theorem which I somehow had missed for many years, but came to it struck me recently. I found it recently, and I'm going to talk about some application of that, which is also which will come later. Okay, so here is the new theorem. Again, it is in the setup of the subsets of Rn. The theorem due to Knezer and Birch, but the proof was given by Mayer, which is more transparent in some way. Okay, so the conditions for the theorem are the following. Take a compact subset S of Rn. This subset S is not the one for which we are going to conclude. I mean, I'm going to construct certain sets for which the property will be claimed. So let me, however, start with a compact. Compact just means closed and bounded subset of the real line, and the of positive Lebesgue measure of positive volume, so to speak. So then, such that no two points of that are congruent modulo Zn. So it should. So let's say I can. We have been talking a lot of what parallelepipeds, so let me take a parallelepiped, and I want to make sure that it is small enough that if I take no two points, the difference of any two points should not be an integer point other than zero itself. I mean, no two distinct points whose difference is an integer point. So take any such set. I mean, there are plenty of them. You can construct many. And okay. And let k be an integer. So there's a certain set whose measure necessarily has to be less than one now, because take an integer which is bigger than or equal to the inverse of that, 1 over mu s, and form now a new set T which is s plus s etc. k copies of that. So starting with any set S, you can form the set s plus s, which means you take an element x in S and another element y in S. Take the sum, that is S plus S. Similarly, this set, what is written here, is x1 plus x2 plus xk with x1, x2, xk running in inside k, so that that makes a certain set. Now, in particular, if you think of you're starting here, it's not assumed to be convex, but if you see that if you actually take a convex set, which like the example I gave you, so in that case, this new set that is formed is simply k times s. So you just have to take s k multiples of each of the s. Okay. So and what do we say about this? This gives you that then every now t is the set about which we are going to make statements, and the statement is something very strong, namely that no matter where you translate t plus v, to take the set v and translate it by any vector that you wish, then this always contains integer points. I should point out that we are not talking about non-zero. For arbitrary translates, we don't need to wonder about whether it is zero or not. So the non-zero is no longer an important significant condition here. So this gives you a way of constructing sets such that, and this is for instance the strips that I mentioned, translates of strips are always have the property that they contain non-zero integer points, and similarly any set constructed in this fashion, so here the sets are compact, so then the strips are not examples of that, so this is a new set of collection of sets which are actually closed and bounded, which not only so the initial set it could perhaps just contain zero, but the additional point is that no matter where I move it, it always contains an integer point. Okay, so the next thing I am going to talk about is an application of this that we made recently, and this is joint work with work of mine with Arnaldo Nogueira. So here we are dealing not with subsets of the Rn in the form that you have been pointing out, but what we are what in the form that I have been drawing. So but the problem here that we are addressing is concerns the following. So okay, so let's first take the n-dimensional space anyway, x1 x2 xp. Now on this, on Rn, when you have Rn and you have any matrix and A in a non-singular matrix, any matrix will act, but I take non-singular GLN R, then this acts on Rn. So I have given any V and A, I get a new vector AV. So any matrix you can think of as acting on the space. Okay, so and when I take GLN R, this action will have an inverse, etc. That's why I take GLN R. So now we are going to be interested with matrices, not with arbitrary real entries, but GLN Z, which means the by definition, this is that is determinant of A is not zero. A has integer entries, and determinant of A is not zero. Okay, so remember that now if I take the inverse, It's not in, will not be inside in general, because the determinant, if it is say determinant is 2, the inverse of the determinant of the inverse is half. So all integers, all entries cannot be integers. So this is actually not a group, but a semi-group. But nevertheless, we can talk of its action. Or in any case, without even reference to actions, etc., we can. There are questions about the solutions that let's look at. So now, before going to the statement of the theorem, let's say I take 2 points in Rn, x and y, and I want to know whether there is an integer, there is a matrix of GL and Z. Gamma such that this is less than epsilon. Whether so, I know that all these matrices act on the space Rn. So I start with a point say V, start with V in Rn, and suppose you are given another vector W in Rn, right? And now the question is, first question is whether you can have matrices such that does there exist in an integer matrix. So this is A in GL and Z such that A V minus W is less than epsilon. This you can think of as the norm of the or the maximum of the entries of absolute values of the entries. So physically what I am saying is I have 2 points, one is V and one is W. Can I have an integer matrix which will take this point epsilon close to the other vector, right? So So in other words, as we say in topology, whether the orbit of GL and Z is dense, orbit of V and in GL and Z is dense. Now it turns out, and this has been known for quite long. It was proved in this was proved in the thesis of Jyotsna Dani, who happens to be my wife. You should not be surprised with the name. And this goes back to the 70s. So as so far we are talking only of this condition. Given any pair of points x and y, provided x, we need to have a condition on this should not be a, if it is a rational point, then of course this will not hold. What will happen is that if you have a point here in which all entries are rational, then when you apply an integer matrix, they will not only remain all rational, but the denominators will stay the same. So therefore, you can always choose y and epsilon so that they will be away from all of those points, that because the denominators are within a certain bounded range. And however, so long as you assume that this sort of thing is not happening, then it is possible to have a solution of this by the result that I mentioned from Jyotsna Dani. The more crucial things that people are concerned these days is whether, so there exists some gamma such that this holds. How can you get a control on that? Because if you want to actually determine with a computer, if you want to find something, you should know. You need to know how far in the space that you have to go to search for your gamma, right? So now the question is: therefore, you would like to know whether there is actually a bound that you can put on the entries of gamma. This is the entries of, so the question addressed here is whether you can have gamma which simultaneously satisfies these two conditions. It takes the point x close to y, and its own size, the size of the matrix is controlled by this. So if you want this to be epsilon close, the theorem tells you that you can do that, and for that you may have to go until gamma which is less than some constant times epsilon raised to minus 1 over rho. There is a certain exponent epsilon that is controlling this, and in this case here any rho less than n minus 1 will do. I mean, there are similar problems, the answer would be different, but in this setup where I have taken gamma to be the full semigroup, we were able to prove that this can always be solved. And here we use the theorem that I mentioned, Birch and Kneiser. What is the connection of this? Notice that if instead of xy integers I take all vectors satisfying these conditions, then this defines a box inside the space of, so if I take, let us take take all matrices A in MnR such that A V, or to conform to the notation there, AX minus Y, AX minus Y has norm less than epsilon, and norm of A is less than some constant times epsilon raised to minus 1 over rho. You can write more general constants here, but I'm just looking at that particular set. Notice that I can think of this as a n square dimensional Euclidean space, right? There are n square entries in the matrix. So this MnR is canonically, it is R power n square, and in this n square dimensional space this defines a box, a parallelepiped. So there is a certain parallelepiped in a n square dimensional space, and Minkowski's theorem, I mean the not Minkowski, Birch and theorem, the Myers theorem that I mentioned tells you that this will contain a non-zero. So I can ignore this point. This is this y. It is actually a translate, so I mean I'm being a bit vague here. So the theorem, using the theorem, one is able to get sets of this form which will necessarily have to have integer points. Okay, and that's the integer point that is coming. But you still need to do something more, because the integer point that you produce may have determinant zero. Then the whole exercise is lost. But then there are some technical points of the theorem of the proof which enable you to get that not only you can find the solution, but you can ensure that using the theorem that its determinant is not zero. Okay, so I'm about to close. So in the theorem as stated is, so take x1, x2, xp, then here it is said, in this formulation I have said that for almost all x1, x2, xp the following holds, and that's the conclusion. Let me not go over it again. So that's the conclusion. Let me say something about this almost all. Now in general, in many contexts, number theory or even outside, when one talks of almost all, there are two kinds of situations. One is the set of points for which there is an exception maybe you understand it, maybe it's just a countable safe, maybe it's just the integers, maybe there can be situations when you actually understand it. But there are situations where you know that it is true for almost all, but you have no understanding about what the exceptional set looks like. There is no way you can tell whether a given point belongs to that exceptional set or not. Okay, so I just want to emphasize that in this case, though we are saying almost all for simplicity, it actually turns out that I can tell precisely which problems, which situations have a problem in that, and that is it's related to a classical notion of something being very well approximable. And analogous to that, we have defined something called projectively very well approximable. And in projectively very well approximable condition, we are able to tell. So the condition precisely turns out to be, instead of almost all, I can say if x is not projectively very well approximable, then the following condition. So it's a very specific statement that one can make. So yeah, right, so here I have described what the relation with the classical notion of very well approximable is. We'll not go into that. So with that, let me thank you for your attention. Sorry?
These are the subsets of RN. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
My concern is if the space is hyperbolic, and if I take a unit ball and then with the Euclidean metric, and I'm told that would serve as a Euclidean thing only, and still those things work in
no, the hyperbolic geometry, the situation will be quite different because the area of the ball or volume of the ball, depending on the dimension, grows exponentially. Therefore the control will not be there. But there may be some results.
Right.
So and. No, there is also another thing that I should point out. See, in the case of, case of Rn, Rn modulo integers is compact. So in other words, there is a compact fundamental domain. Now, in the hyperbolic case, if you take the group of integers, for instance, the quotient is not compact. So there is a certain skip.
Kind of thing will come.
On the other hand, if you take certain kinds of algebraic numbers where this quotient is compact, then better results will be available. That's roughly.
Yeah.